It is so good to be gathered together. So let's stand as we worship Him. We worship the King of Kings. Come on. Come on, sing with me. We worship the God who was. We worship the God who is. We worship the God who evermore will be. He opened the prison doors. He parted the raging sea. Oh my God, He holds the victory. Come on, sing it.
We were the prisoners, but now we're This passage over us is from Colossians chapter 3, and it says, "Let the peace of Christ rule in your hearts, since as members of one body you were called to peace, and be thankful. Let the message of Christ dwell among you richly, as you teach and admonish one another with all wisdom through psalms, hymns, and songs from the Spirit, singing to God with gratitude in your hearts. And whatever you do, whether in word or in deed, do it all in the name of Jesus, giving thanks to God the Father through him." Church, we all have a reason to express gratitude to Christ. And this morning, we want to take a moment to thank Jesus for who he is and what he's done in each of our lives. So as we sing this next song and prepare for open mic scripture, we want those who have one or two verses expressing their thankfulness to Jesus to ready themselves, and please come forward during this song so that following this song we may all benefit from the testimonies of Christ's impact in our lives.
All that I have is a hallelujah. Zephaniah chapter 3, verses 17. The Lord your God is in your midst, a mighty one who will save. He will rejoice over you with gladness. He will quiet you by his love. He will exalt over you with singing.
Revelation 3:19. Those whom I love, I rebuke and discipline. So be earnest and repent. Here I am. I stand at the door and knock. If anyone hears my voice and opens the door, I will come in and eat with that person and they with me.
Psalm 45, 1 and 2. My heart overflows with a good theme. I address my verses to the king. My tongue is the pen of a ready writer. Thou art fairer than the sons of men. Grace is poured upon thy lips. Therefore, God has blessed thee forever.
Psalm 103, 10 and 14. He does not deal with us according to our sins, nor repay us according to our iniquities. For he knows our frame. He remembers that we are dust.
Psalm 18, 27. For you save a humble people, but the haughty eyes you bring down. For it is you who light my lamp. The Lord God lightens my darkness. For by you I can run against a troop, and by my God I can leap over a wall. This God, his way is perfect. The word of the Lord proves true. He is a shield for all those who take refuge in him.
Luke 2:49. And he said to them, why were you looking for me? Did you not know that I must be in my Father's house?
Psalm 28:7. The Lord is my strength and my shield. My heart trusts in him, and I am helped. My heart leaps for joy, and I will give thanks to him in everything with songs.
Philippians 4:4-7. Rejoice in the Lord always. Again, I will say rejoice. Let your reasonableness be known to everyone. The Lord is at hand. Do not be anxious about anything, but in everything, by prayer and supplication with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known to God, and the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. Yep. Amen. Yep.
Psalms 118:28-29. You are my God, and I will praise you. You are my God, and I will exalt you. Give thanks to the Lord, for he is good, and his love endures forever.
I've made this the anchor verse of my life in the last couple weeks. Joshua 1:9. Have I not commanded you? Be strong and courageous. Do not be afraid. Do not be discouraged. For the Lord your God is with you wherever you go. Amen.
Church, we have another reason to be thankful. Philippians 2, Paul says this. He says, have the same mindset as Christ Jesus, who being in the very nature of God, did not consider equality with God something to be used to his own advantage. But rather, he made himself nothing by taking the very nature of a servant, being made in human likeness, and being found in appearance as a man. He humbled himself by becoming obedient to death, even death on a cross. And therefore God exalted him to the highest place and gave him the name that is above every name, that at the name of Jesus every knee should bow in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue acknowledge that Jesus is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. Let's continue to worship because of this.
The Son of God, adore.
behold the cross.
Behold the cross that shadows eternity. For God so loved, he hung there where I should be. From death to life, now ruling in mercy. Christ the Son of God, adore Him. He who was and is to come, and He shall reign forevermore, and He shall reign God, one day He will come again.
It's true.
He will restore the world that belongs to Him.
The earth will shake.
The earth will shake. The kingdom of God is here.
We behold,
behold Him. Jesus Christ.
Father, you are good, you are great, Lord, we are here to make great your name. We are here to lift you high because, God, you have been so good to us. Lord, there is no other name that is greater than the name of Jesus. So, God, we give you our praise. We give you our affection. We give you our worship. We give you our lives because you are worthy. We give this all to you in the great name of Jesus. And everybody said, amen. It's great to worship together, Harvest family. You guys can go ahead and have a seat. My name is Larry Geisler. I get to serve here as our pastor of Harvest Young Adults and Harvest Students. It's great to be here. And if this is your first time at Harvest Bible Chapel, I want to give you just a special welcome. We're glad that you're here this morning. And if you're looking for any answers to questions you have about our church or looking to be connected in any way, please stop by after the service. I'll be at our welcome gathering place in the lobby. You can't miss it. Please just come say hi. We'd love to hear how God brought you here this morning and help you in any way that I can. So please come say hi. And for everybody, it's our goal as a church family to help you to grow as a disciple of Jesus, to be cared for. Some of the ways that we do that are found in the Church Center app. So you can take this time right now to open that up, or you can scan a QR code on a seat in front of you. One of the things you can do there is check in, fill out the Connect card, let us know that you're here so that we can tap you on the shoulder when you're not and say, hey, we miss you. We want you to come worship with us. And then secondly, if there's anything that's on your heart or your mind and you're praying for, we want to pray for you as well. So please submit your prayer requests in the app. Our staff sees those. We pray for those every single week. So we'd love to be praying for whatever it is that the Lord has on your heart right now. And who's been enjoying good weather? Anybody? Praise God. Saw some people with sunburn today. Let's go. Look, we've got the good weather's coming. We got a lot of reasons to be outside. And so if you're a young adult, like ages 18 to 35, we have a retreat coming up at Camp Harvest in Newaygo, Michigan, Memorial Day weekend. So we're just a few weeks away. It's going to be May 24th to the 27th, Friday night to Monday morning, afternoon. We would love for you to come join us. It's going to be a weekend to really just fellowship together, have great time with other young adults, meet new friends, have fun outside, be alone with the Lord, and worship together, be taught. The theme this year is, whom shall I fear? Talking about all the things in this world that can grab our attention, that can grab our fear, when really our devotion is to the Lord. So whom shall we fear? So we would love for you to join us for that Memorial Day weekend. You can sign up or find more information at campharvest.com. We want to prepare for our monthly offering, our special offering, which is in the same vein of things outdoors and camps of sorts. We're going to be giving towards scholarships for both High Five and student camps. So High Five is our week-long day camp for preschool through fifth grade, where they get to come together and have lots of fun, do things that are outrageous and crazy. But every day, they come in here and they hear the gospel. Every day, they come in here and they worship Jesus together. And so there are some kids who come to know Jesus for the first time at these, and these scholarships are going to go towards paying for those who can't afford to come. Same thing at student camp. We go to Camp Harvest. We have a junior high week and a high school week. Many of them hear the gospel for the first time, or many of them are going through something or had a hard year, and it's time to surrender all of that to the Lord, to have people around them who can care for them and pray for them and help them walk with Jesus, hopefully for the rest of their lives. And so your offerings are going to go towards helping families that can't afford this, or families that have four or five or six kids, be able to send their kids to High Five and Camp Harvest this year. So if you want to give to the special offering, you can give online through midnight tonight, or you can give at either one of the doors. There'll be ushers there who would love to take any offerings that you might have. But I want to read this scripture over us from 2 Corinthians that gives us a little bit of insight into the heart posture of somebody who's giving. It says, the point is this: whoever sows sparingly will also reap sparingly, and whoever sows bountifully will also reap bountifully. Each one must give as he has decided in his heart, not reluctantly, not under compulsion, but for God loves a cheerful giver. And God is able to make all grace abound to you so that having all sufficiency in all things at all times, you may abound in every good work. And so when you hear us talking about opportunities to give to things like this, you don't give because some guy just asked you to. You don't give because you feel like you have to do that to be right before God. You give because you are made right before God. You give because he is good. You give because he does love you and he has given you so much. And so you can give in your weekly offering in any of the ways that you see on the screen here or online when you get home, whatever. It doesn't matter. But I just want to take some time to pray that the Lord would use these offerings and he would bless them and pray for this gathering this morning. Would you join me? Father, we love you so much. You are the reason we're here. You're the reason we get to have this church community, this fellowship. You're the reason that we have salvation. You're the reason we have anything that we have. And so, Lord, we give you our praise and our worship. And, Lord, we give you our finances. We give back to you what you have graciously given to us. Lord, not because we have to, but because we get to, Lord. We know that the only thing that matters in this world is your kingdom, that your kingdom would come, that people would come to know Jesus. And so, Lord, I pray for these offerings that are going towards High Five and camp scholarships, that, Lord, because of this money, that there would be students and kids who come to know who you are, that people would be saved because of the generosity of your church. And so, Lord, I just pray that you pave the way for that right now. Lord, I pray that our offerings would allow us to have opportunity to reach into our community, that we'd be able to care for people that need it. We'd be able to tangibly show the love of Christ to people around us. Lord, would you multiply these offerings? God, would you use them in amazing ways? Lord, we pray for Pastor Jeff as he opens your word, that God, you fill him with your spirit to have the confidence that it's you who speaks. Would he be a mouthpiece for you? And Lord, I pray for all of us. You give us ears to hear what you have to say, that God, you would produce fruit in our church through the preaching of your word. So God, we give this all to you. We trust you with it in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, guys, we're going to prepare for our teaching. You can open up your Bibles to 1 Peter. And while you do that, why don't you stand up, find a brother or sister in Christ around you that maybe you don't know yet. Introduce yourself.
If you're first time here or you don't know me at all, my name's Jeff. I get the privilege of teaching the Bible here, and so you're going to need a Bible. In 1 Peter chapter 2, as we'll be in the next few minutes, 1 Peter chapter 2, verses 11 and 12. Before I get into talking about that, though, I need to first give you some really cool news. We're taking a special offering this weekend. We've been doing that for the last about a year and a bit. Part of the reason that we do that, or the main reason, is we're trying to engender generosity in our church as much as we can. It's kind of one of our pieces that we believe that God has placed us here so we could be a particularly generous people and see his kingdom grow all over the place. So this year, the beginning of the year, so like we do years and quarters, the first quarter of the year before April, the average of the special offering that we take every month was about $10,000 a month, which is amazing because a lot of that money ends up going into what we call benevolence funds or compassion ministries and these sorts of things. Like some of it goes to our Hope Center, and sometimes we have special offerings like this week where we're collecting money for scholarships for kids to camp and these sorts of things. And so all of that money gets to be used in all of those fantastic ways. But in April, we asked everybody if they would be willing to give to ministries that are in our local area. And so Harvest is collecting the money, but we're not keeping any of it. We're actually going to be using it to actually write checks to different ministries that we're partnering with in our local community. So each one of our campuses had a list of ministries that they were partnering with. And so in April, we had 13 different organizations that we were partnering with, and the total offering across all our campuses was $45,000, which is really cool. So we have all of, so lots of different folks are going to receive food. We have some pregnancy centers and some different groups that are all involved in receiving that. And so this last week has been really cool because some of our care pastors have been cutting checks and they're giddy about it. Like, this is so cool that we get to actually go out. And in some cases, those ministries haven't asked us to do any of that kind of thing. And so as a result, we're just being able to give it to them freely. So thank you so much for your generosity and for your willingness to give. It is a real ministry to people around us and a testimony to the God we serve, which is a great segue into this passage that we're going to look at here in the next couple of minutes, especially the ending of it, which talks about the impact that we have in the communities around us when we live faithful Christian lives. Like I said, 1 Peter chapter 2, verses 11 and 12 is where we'll be in the next few minutes. When you spend enough time in a church or you go to seminary, which is where pastors are trained, you spend enough time listening to sermons, you end up hearing sometimes the same stories because, as a pastor, you'll listen to a story and be like, well, that's really a good illustration of the point that speaker is trying to make. And so one of those stories that has gone around for years, but I don't know if it's true or not, right? So I imagine if you went to the Snopes.com website, they might be like, no, that's not true. They also don't think Jesus is God, so, take them with a grain of salt. So the story, though, is about the way Eskimos kill wolves. And apparently, if you're an Eskimo and you are having trouble with wolves around your Eskimo-ness, you take some blood. Whose blood, I don't know. Maybe the older wolf you just killed. But you take some blood and you'll dip a knife in that blood and then it'll freeze. And then you dip the knife in some more blood and it'll freeze on top of the other blood. And then you dip a knife in and freeze. And eventually you get like layers of blood on this knife, and then you stick the knife out in the, into the snow with blade up, and you just let it sit there, and eventually the wolves will come along, and they will start licking the knife, thinking that it's, a bloodsicle. It's like your little kid and the ice cream truck comes along. This is the wolf version of that, apparently. And they come out and they start licking it because they love the blood and they can't stop. And eventually, of course, they lick it all the way down to the point where they have the blade itself being revealed. But they don't realize that it's cutting their tongue, and now they're licking their own blood. And eventually, they bleed out, right? In a beautiful story. Now, I have no idea if that's the way. If you go up to an Eskimo someday or somebody who lives way, way northern Canada, and you say to them, so where's your knife with the blood on it? They'll be like, what are you talking about? Well, my pastor. If you say, I have no idea. I don't, I'm not an Eskimo. But usually pastors, what they'll do is they'll use that as an illustration for the effect of sin in the life of any person, Christian, otherwise. That, sin is the kind of thing that's really appealing at the front end. If you want to disobey God and you go away from his way, but you want to obey the passions of the flesh, is the language that we'd use, that the desires that you have to please yourself in a particular way, if you go into that, what you'll find is that it has a kind of fleeting joy. There is legitimate, excitement in it. Anybody who's ever engaged in any kind of sinful activity knows that there's this like rush that you get at the front end. But the problem is, the more you get involved in it, the more it has the potential to kill you, and often does. Tell you stories as a pastor of people who've engaged in certain sinful activities thinking, no, it's not a big deal, and then they justify it, and then eventually, you know, their faith is gone, or it ends them up in some of the worst places ever. And if you talk to them later, they'll say, I wish I never even got involved to begin with. This is a really common perspective in Scripture, this warning against sin and its effects. One of the most engaging images of that is actually in the book of Proverbs. Proverbs is written by an older gentleman who is trying to train his young sons on how to live wise lives. And in Proverbs chapter 7, you have this kind of, Proverbs are usually these little small statements, you know, word in the hand is worth two in the bush. That kind of thing is proverbial. But in Proverbs 7, you get this kind of story, a very vivid story that's shocking regarding sin. So I just want to read it to you just to give you an example of how the Bible talks about this danger of sin. It's in Proverbs chapter 7, verse 6. So it's about a man who's looking out through his window and he sees the way that a young man walks into sexual sin. Here's how it goes. For at the window of my house, I have looked out through my lattice, and I have seen among the simple, I have perceived among the youths, a young man lacking sense, passing along the street near her corner, taking the road to her house in the twilight, in the evening, at the time of night and darkness. So there's a woman standing on a corner when it's getting dark outside, and she is inviting someone to her house. You could probably put together who this is. And behold, the woman meets him, and she's dressed as a prostitute, wily of heart. And she's loud and wayward. Her feet don't stay at home, now in the street, now in the market. And at every corner, she lies in wait. So it's not easy. It's not like she's just on this one particular corner. She could be anywhere, my young friend. Wherever it is that you travel, she's there. And she seizes him and kisses him. And with bold face, she says to him, now I'm going to do her voice here, all right? Just bring it to life a little bit. I had to offer sacrifices. And today I've paid my vows. So now I've come out to meet with you, to seek you eagerly. And I found you. I've spread my couch with coverings, colored linens from Egyptian linen. I've perfumed my bed with myrrh, aloes, cinnamon. Come, let us take our fill of love till morning. Let us delight ourselves with love. For my husband is not at home. He's gone on a long journey. He took a bag of money with him. At full moon, he'll come. He's gone a month. He's got lots of money. He's going to be able to spend lots of time away. There's no risk. Just come. With much seductive speech, she persuades him. With her smooth talk, she compels him. And all at once, he follows her. As an ox goes to the slaughter. Or as a stag is caught fast till an arrow pierces its liver, as a bird rushes into a snare, he does not know that it will cost him his life. And now, O sons, listen to me. and be attentive to the words of my mouth. Let not your heart turn aside to her ways. Do not stray into her paths, for many a victim has she laid low, and all her slain are a mighty throng. There are so many who've gone before you and have experienced the death. They've been caught in the snare. Don't think that you're going to somehow get away with it because you're special or unique or you know better. Her house is the way to Sheol. Going down to the chambers of death. So sin looks great, but it'll kill you. So that leads me to a question. If you're a Christian, and meaning, of course, that you've said, I don't want to follow my former manner of life. I don't want to follow the lusts of the flesh and desires of my heart. I want to follow the desires of God. I'm going to deny myself, take up my cross. I'm going to follow Jesus. I'm going to follow him the rest of my life on earth so I can spend the rest of eternity with him and the joy of his Father. Okay, I'm committed to Jesus. And I know, as a Christian, that Scripture warns me against the dangers of sin. And it's not just Scripture. I know from experience that in my own life, that the times that I have given in to particular sins, they have looked good on the surface, but have ended up yielding terrible death, destitution. I know it from my friends' experiences. I know it from my experiences. I know it from Scripture. So as a Christian, my question is, why are we so plagued by besetting sins? I'm not asking that rhetorically. I'm actually interested. Like if we know that there's a cliff and that everyone who's gone down there has gone over the cliff, why do we run so headlong toward the cliff? Why are so many Christians bound up in besetting sins? Why do so many Christians profess belief in Christ, right? And, oh, I trust that God is sovereign. And, oh, I trust, and yet they worry like crazy. Why is it that we say, oh, no, Jesus is my one true love, but we seek joy and passion and not obeying his rules for love? Why do we struggle to obey Jesus? If you have ever asked that question, or if you've ever even thought about it, this passage in 1 Peter chapter 2 is helpful. 1 Peter 2, verses 11 and 12. We were going to do a longer section today, but I shrunk it down to two verses because I find these so helpful as it pertains to dealing with the challenge of sin in the life of a believer. Because in this passage, you're going to see that it describes the motivation for and the power of noble Christian conduct. Like obedience to God, noble Christian conduct. What are the reasons for it? How can we conquer sin in our lives? And what happens to the people around us when we do? So, in this passage, I've kind of identified three resources for fighting sin, or three marks of Christian conduct that I think are really important to know. Number one, I think Christian conduct, holy Christian conduct, is fueled by Christian position. Second, Christian conduct results from winning the inner war. And third, Christian conduct has apologetic power. I'll explain each one of those as we go, and I'll repeat them as we go along here. But here's the first of them, all right? Christian conduct is fueled by Christian position. So 1 Peter chapter 2, verse 11. In our series on 1 Peter, we're taking just a real short text here to talk about sin. Beloved, he says, I urge you as sojourners and exiles to abstain from the passions of the flesh, which wage war against your soul. We are, according to Peter, sojourners and exiles. And his command, his urging of us to do a particular thing is based upon the fact that we are a particular thing, namely sojourners and exiles. That's a really, really important point. Okay, so we're going to do our little English class here for just a second. I know you tried to avoid it the most you possibly could when you were in school, and you never knew you'd come to church and the guy would start talking about English. But listen, there's a difference between an indicative verb and an imperative verb. You guys remember what verbs are? Like action words, right? Do, work. Feel. These are all action words. So when you have an action word, okay, and you can have different forms of that action word. One of those is so let's use the word of the idea of being kind. It's the action word. If I'm speaking about an indicative, what I'm saying is that you are kind. It's a statement of fact. It's a statement of what is true. In the present moment, you are kind, you are noble, you are quiet, some of you. You are like, you are. This is what you have. You have. Indicative. An imperative is a command. Be kind. You are kind. Indicative, be kind. Imperative. If you're a parent, you spend a lot of time with the imperatives, don't you? If you're trying to affirm your friend, you spend a lot of time in the indicative. This is really important to know because most of the first part of 1 Peter, so 1 Peter chapter 1, spends an enormous amount of time in the indicative. There are a few imperatives, there's no question about that, but most of the verbs that are used there are indicative verbs, meaning, let me tell you what you are. So what are you? Well, Peter goes in great detail about what you are, O Christian. Verse 1, Peter, an apostle of Jesus Christ, to those who are elect exiles of the dispersion. You've been scattered all over the place, the dispersion. Your Christians are all over the place, he's saying. But here's what you are. You are elect, chosen by God. Exiles, meaning that you don't fit within the society in which you live because your home is ultimately in the new heavens and new earth, and the kingdom of God is your great kingdom, and you live in the kingdoms of this age, and therefore you kind of feel awkward in those places like an exile would feel, like a stranger would feel. So you are an elect exile. The next few verses, verse 3. So we're going to verse 1 and then verse 3, 1 Peter 1. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. According to his great mercy, he has caused us to be born again to a living hope. So here's what's true about you. This is an indicative statement. God has caused you to be born again. Your born againness, the fact that you're a Christian, is caused by God. And it's resulted, of course, in your position now as someone who is reborn to a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead. You've been born again to an inheritance that is imperishable, undefiled, and unfading, and it's kept in heaven for you. And so what's another indicative about you, another thing that's true about you, is that you are a person who has an inheritance in heaven, and it's being kept for you. You not keeping it. God is the one who's holding it, right? Like your great-grandfather's holding an inheritance for you. You're in the will. And so God is keeping this inheritance for you. Who you are, by God's power, being guarded through faith for a salvation ready to be revealed at the last time. And so you've been given this salvation, you've elect, you've been given this salvation. The inheritance that's the result of the salvation is being kept in heaven for you, and you are being guarded in the present time, you know? Like, the president of the United States has his secret service around him, and they're like running along the side of the motorcade, making sure that nobody does anything. God himself is running alongside of your life, making sure that you are going to reach the destination that he has set out for you, where you're going to inherit the $1 billion. These are all truths about you. There's nobody saying, get the million, get the billion, keep yourself. Nope. Being kept, being guarded, all of these things are true about you. 1 Peter 2, 9 and 10. Skipping forward just a few verses. You are a chosen race, a royal priesthood, and a holy nation. You are a people for his own possession. Those are true about you. He's made all of he has transferred you from the kingdom of darkness to the kingdom of God's dear son. That's where you are, praise God. Those are indicative. So when you get to our passage that we're dealing with here, you need the first thing you need to notice is, beloved, I urge you, as what you are, sojourners and exiles. He's trying to draw your attention back to all the things he said in chapter 1 about what's true about you. Because, and here's the important bit. Indicatives drive imperatives. The way to do something for Jesus is to know what you are in Jesus. Because we're not home here, in other words, right? We're strangers and aliens. We shouldn't act like we're home here. Because we have a different king, we shouldn't submit to the values of another kingdom, regardless of how much we feel it. No matter how much the passions of the flesh call us, We don't have to, because that's not who we are. Maybe an image like this. I went to snooty families sometimes, like the Bucknams. It doesn't, Bucknam's not really a snooty name, right? But let's pretend it is, and that I'm very snooty, which is probably true. So, snooty families will, if you have a son and your son is out and he's acting in a particular way and he's getting mixed up with all the wrong people, and he's throwing eggs at houses during Halloween, and he's soaking those eggs in vinegar, and he's TPing everyone's place, and he's, getting involved in drugs and all sorts of things, and he ends up getting arrested, and, snooty father Dr. Bucknam shows up, wearing my coat and tie, which is what I wear, and so I walk in, and I gather my son, and I pay the money, and I gather him, and I put my arm around him as we're walking back to the car, and I say to him, son, I'm very disappointed in you. You're a Bucknam. And what am I trying to say to him? All of the activities that you have just done are not in line with who you are, son. Because here's what's fundamentally true about you. You have a name and a lineage and support and all the things that you ought to have, and you're a Bucknam. Act like a Bucknam. So Christian, you are a Christian, chosen by God, royal priesthood, holy nation, elect exile, all of those things. Those are all true about you. I don't care where you feel like they're true about you. They are true about you. You can try to dupe yourself every morning and say they're not. But the reason I gave you, for those of you here last week, a homework project to get up every morning and remind yourself about what's true is because all of the imperatives, all of the commands of the faith are built on the indicatives and truths of the faith. So who are you? Well, I'm a sojourner and exile. Who are you? I'm a royal priesthood. I'm a holy nation. Who are you? An elect exile. The key to acting like obedient children of the king is knowing that we are children of the king. And I know, listen, I know that's hard. I do, because when we really get down to the point where you apply this to the moment where sin is calling, and when the sinful passions are calling you out, you know, and they're saying, go do this thing that is alien to God's way. Ah, God and his stupid viewpoints regarding, you know, sexuality and greed and all the stuff that is, ignore all of it. The good life is held over here. And your insides are going, yes, that way. Yes, that way. In that moment, there's a fight. But here's, the fight begins, though, with you saying to that voice, I don't have to. I pretend that you had a really horrible job, which for some of you is not hard. You're like, pretend. Okay, you pretend you have a really horrible job, and the job is horrible because the boss is horrible, like Harvest. So it's really terrible, and you show up to work, and the boss is really mean, and he treats you terribly, and you only do it because it pays a certain amount of money, but you've been doing it for 15, 20 years. You're so accustomed to jumping whenever the boss tells you to jump. Well, one day you get a phone call from, I don't know, Indeed or Monster.com or whatever. Hey, we got another job for you. It's like 2 minutes from your house. It's in this company that's going to pay you twice as much. It's going to provide you all of the life-work balance that you've ever wanted. The health care is better. It's all better. Everything's better. And you jump at the chance, and you go over to this other job, and it is it's better than what they described. Your boss is amazing. Gives you all sorts of freedom. You feel completely fulfilled. You're there for 6 months, and then you get a phone call one early Monday morning, and the phone is from your old boss, and your old boss says to you, hey, I'm gonna need you in the office this morning. And you say, okay. Right? Well, no, of course you don't. Why don't you, though? Hey, why don't you? You spent years answering to the guy, doing exactly what he said. And if I, in that moment, came to you and say, why aren't you answering your boss? You'd say, because he's not my boss. I've been freed from that, and now I'm bound to another. Right? Right? So when the old way, to use the language of the old scriptures, right, the old man calls you out and says, listen, you do this particular thing because it's going to be way better for you, except not God's way, this other way. And when it calls you out like that, the response you should have immediately is, no, I don't have to. I know where you want to lead me. You want to lead me down that street where that boy is and the guy was looking out through the lattice. And I know you make it look awesome, like a timeshare. But I know what happens when you buy the timeshare. Stuck with it forever, and it ruins your life. I don't want my life ruined. What are you talking about? I'm not going your way. You've done enough to me. I answer to a different king. Listen, you will never have any victory over sin. You will have never have any victory over Satan or the flesh until you realize that the first step is recognizing that you do not belong to them. You belong to another. Okay? Second, so Christian conduct is fueled by Christian position. And second, Christian conduct results from winning the inner war. You're saying, what inner war? Well, it's right here. First verse again, beloved, or verse 11 of 1 Peter 2. Beloved, I urge you, yes, as sojourners and exiles, okay, but I'm urging you, based upon this indicatives, to abstain from the passions of the flesh. The desires inside, you know what those desires are. The things that are calling you to disobey God, even though you love God and you want to serve him, the draw away to things that are alien to him and that are contrary and rebellious to him. Those things are calling you, and they are passions of the flesh. And they, notice the language, wage war against your soul. I love Peter, right? if there's an easy way, if there's like a bland way to say it, he never chooses the bland way. He's, let me give you a picture in your head about what it looks like for you to fight sin. It's waging war against you. So in your head, you got to be start thinking, okay, what does that look like? Hey, one of the greatest miniseries in the history of the world is Band of Brothers. Amen. Every guy in the room's like, yeah. Look, there's some violence and things in it. The guy from Friends is in it, and he's a bad guy, just like in Friends. And that's a good joke. So in this show, it's like 10 parts, and it follows the 101st Airborne across World War II. And in the middle of it, there's one episode called Bastogne. Bastogne is actually a description, right? An hour-long episode basically trying to describe what was called the Battle of the Bulge. And what happened to the 101st Airborne is that they got surrounded by the Nazis in a forest near Bastogne. And there they are in the middle of this forest, and for the entire winter, they have to dig holes and basically just hold out. They don't have any support. They don't have any materials. They're eating bark off of trees. And they're being constantly assaulted with mortars and gunfire and assaults from different corners. It gets so bad, in fact, that they get so foggy and cold that sometimes they're wandering in the woods and they don't know anywhere that they are. And sometimes they go across enemy lines and the enemies come across their lines and they start shooting at each other. But basically, the whole show is following this medic around to the showing how horrible this particular period of the war was and how amazing it is that they were able to persevere through all of it. But the scenes are shocking. I mean, the mortars are coming and they're blowing up trees around everybody and they're falling right into ditches and people's legs are getting blown off. And that's what it looks like for someone to wage war against you. They're seeking your destruction, right? They're not trying to say, hey, can we play by the Queensberry rules or whatever? They're trying to kill you and destroy the team you play for, the country you represent. You like Lord of the Rings? It's when the bad guys come and assault Helm's Deep. And they get to the edge of the orcs and everything are coming to the door of the castle. And they're going to take it over. And there's no hope inside. There's none. That's what it looks like. And so what Peter's trying to get you to think is, listen, you're in a fight, man. There's an actual war being waged in your soul. And the passions of your flesh, the sinful passions, are assaulting you, trying to destroy you. There are blood knives everywhere. All around. It's interesting that he uses this image because when you get back to the very beginning of the Bible, okay, and when sin first enters the whole story in Genesis chapter 3, you know, Adam and Eve have a kid, two kids, in fact, Cain and Abel. Abel's a pretty good kid. He worships the Lord and stuff, but Cain, he's got a bad attitude. In Genesis 4, verse 7, here's what God says to Cain. He says, if you do well, Cain, will you not be accepted? And if you do not do well, here's your problem. Cain, sin is crouching at the door. Its desire is contrary to you. It's a very nice way of saying, it's against you, man. But you must rule over it. It wants to destroy you, and you must rule over it. Cain, you're in a fight. You're in a fight right now, and sin is crouching at the door. There's the same language is used of lions in the Bible, which makes me think, of course, of the time that I was in the Christchurch Zoo in New Zealand with my little 2-year-old boy, Micah. And the Christchurch Zoo had the most important thing for a 2-year-old boy is to see the lion exhibit. So they had, of course, the lions, which were behind this massive chain link fence with the top so they can't jump over. And there's the fence, but you can't go right up to the fence and put your fingers through for a little, you know, ooh, kitty, kitty. You stay back behind the other fence, which is also a chain link fence. So here's my little two-year-old, and he's got a stick in his hand. He loves lions, and he's looking at him, and he's dragging his stick along the fence, the little fence. And he's got like six lionesses walking with him everywhere he goes. He's going back. He'd stop. They stop. He moves this way. They move this way. And I didn't notice it for a while, and then I was realizing, man, I am thankful that there's a fence there because this kid would be lion meat. He would be so done because of this. Right. So many of us are like my son, completely unaware that sin is crouching at the door and its desire is for you. It's waging war against your soul. We are in a war within. We battle sinful desires that actively and continually assault our souls and must be defended against. Holy conduct and honorable lives are the result of winning that war. The way that you live out Christian living is by winning inside against the sins of the flesh, which are waging war against you. So look, you need to play the part of the general who is, you know, at command center and looking at, okay, where in our sphere or life is there a weak spot? Because we do have good defenses in certain areas. There are certain things that you're not going to be tempted by as much as other things, but there are some things that you are tempted by, and you need to look at those places and say, okay, this is an area where we're weak, where our defenses aren't holding up quite as well. Anybody in any war, this is like the first thing that they would do. How do we repel the enemy when they come and they give their assault? We need to build up in those places. I'll give you a story about a guy who didn't build up. It's probably one of the most famous ones in all of the Bible. And it resulted in probably one of the saddest occasions ever. It was David and his sin with Bathsheba. I'm just read you the first few verses of 2 Samuel 11, give you an idea as to what's going on with him. He's at his highest height at this point in the book, okay? Like David is, he's the greatest king, he's the greatest everything, okay? So in the spring of the year, the time when kings go out to battle. By the way, what is David? I can't remember what his title is. Oh, king. Okay, so where should David be in the spring of the time of the year when the kings go to war? Well, he should be where the kings go, at war. All right, during this particular spring, because everything's going so well and he's like dominating all his enemies, David sent Joab. Well, I don't need to go. I'll just send one of my lieutenants. He sent Joab and his servants with them and all Israel. So all the people who are part of his, you know, team, his core group are out. All the guys who might challenge him, all the people who might keep an account, all the yes people have stayed behind, of course, you know, the attendants and stuff, but all the others, they're out fighting the war that David himself is supposed to be at. And it works. They ravaged the Ammonites and besieged Rabbah. And you can, of course, see David going like, I don't even need to go anywhere. This is amazing. It's way better being back at home because I can take a nap. He remained at Jerusalem, and it happened. It just so happened. Late one afternoon, after he'd had his sleepy sleeps, when David arose from his couch and was walking on the roof of the king's house. You ever had that afternoon feeling? Oh, I fell asleep. I'm so tired. I'm going to go outside and feel the breeze. The king's house, of course, is a roof, and it goes out, and every king put their house on top of a hill because I'm more important than you and closer to God, and so my house is on top of the hill. And, of course, all of the other houses were below, and if you don't know the way houses were built in those days, the central courtyard was always open air, and it was where you did things like bath. You didn't have a bathroom. You would do it out in the open because nobody could see you except maybe the king, who's never there because he's out to war in the springtime. Yeah? David rose from his couch. He's walking on the roof of the king's house. And he saw from the roof a woman bathing. Which, of course, you'd naturally be doing this in the open air because that's where you did it, in your house. Nobody could see you. The woman was very beautiful. And David's... He had an opportunity here, didn't he? Whoa, she's beautiful. I'm going to go back inside. But, you know, he's a little bit groggy. He shouldn't be there in the first place. So David sent and inquired about the woman. And one of the people said, is not this Bathsheba, the daughter of Eliam, the wife, David, she's married, the wife of Uriah the Hittite? And David, being the noble king, said, oh, yeah, that's not a good idea. Yeah, it's not a good idea. No, David sent messengers and you see the language, right? He took her. And she came to him and he lay with her. Do you know the rest of the story about David and his kingdom is about their child. She gives birth, of course, and that child dies. David's got another son, Absalom, who ends up declaring war against David. His entire house is destroyed because he wasn't doing what he was supposed to. Because David decided as the great king that he was not going to guard the personal defenses. He's basically a guy on a diet who's saying, you know what? I'm just going to go to Spunky Dunkers and get some donuts, you know, in case later in the evening I need them. What if the zombie apocalypse happens and I need to have the donuts and they're all I have? I'm just going to put over here just in case. Listen to me. It's not hard. Don't buy donuts when you're on a diet. Just don't buy them. Don't make any provision for the flesh. Romans 13:14, but put on the Lord Jesus Christ and make no provision for the flesh to gratify its desires. Give no quarter to it. Give no space to it. Jesus actually uses language like, if its right hand's causing you to sin, cut it off. You're in a war. And the result of that war is going to determine whether or not the Christian conduct that you might so desire shows up or not. So where are your defenses weak? What provisions are you making for the flesh? How many donuts do you have on the counter? All right, last one. So Christian conduct is fueled by Christian position, and Christian conduct results from winning the inner war. And then finally, there's an effect that Christian conduct has on everybody who's watching when they see you actually live faithful Christian life. It has an apologetic power. And when I use the language apologetic, I'm not saying, oh, I'm so sorry, I'm a Christian. I mean, it's got an argument for the faith power. So here's the second verse, right? So first verse, verse 11. Here's the second verse, verse 12. Keep your conduct among the Gentiles. This is the way that Peter talks about the unbelievers in the Old Testament. Those people who are outside the community of faith were called Gentiles. And so Peter carries that language over and says, look, he's using the word Gentiles to talk about people outside the church. Keep your conduct among the unbelievers honorable, so that when they speak against you as evildoers, they will speak against you as evildoers. That's just what it looks like to live in a society that doesn't think you're all that great. And we live in that society today. What's interesting is that the society that Peter lived in was on the front edge of what eventually became a really, really hostile persecution. In fact, one of the early church fathers was a guy named Tertullian. I think I've shared this before. It's a very famous quote from the early church. Tertullian, he wrote a book called Apology. And it was an argument for the faith in the face of all these people who wanted to destroy the Christian church and hurt Christians. And so he was trying to say, you shouldn't be hurting Christians. I think you guys don't have the right understanding of who Christians are. Because the way that they thought about it is they were like, you Christians commit incest, you know? They get together and they call each other brother and sister. I love my brothers and sisters. They eat the body and blood of their Lord. Cannibals. They worship one God. Atheists. But what about all the other gods? They're all going to get mad. I've shared this before, right? So anytime anything bad happened, they blame it on the Christians. In fact, very famous quote from Tertullian. He said, if the Tiber, which is a river, if the Tiber rises as high as the city walls, so if there's a big flood, if the Nile does not send its water up over the fields, so there's not enough rain, if the heavens give no rain, if there's an earthquake, if there's a famine or pestilence, straight away the cry is away with the Christians to the lion. Doesn't matter what happens, it's we Christians who are at fault because we're immoral. And that's the way they viewed them, which should sound really familiar. So they are, when they speak against you as evildoers, keep your conduct honorable so that when they speak against you as evildoers, and they will, they may see your good deeds and glorify God on the day of visitation. This is a reference to the return of Christ. In other words, you're supposed to live such noble Christian lives, even in the face of accusation and persecution. So when they see your response, they say to themselves, that's unique. Everybody else fights back and screams and yells and wants to get into a war, but these people respond in love. What's going on with that? Who is this God that they serve? I want to know more. So you get examples of this in the Bible. One of my favorite places is when this Philippian jailer, Paul and Silas, are imprisoned, right? They've caused a real ruckus in the city of Philippi, and so they go into prison after being beaten. And about midnight, Paul and Silas are praying and singing hymns to God, which is what you do when you're beaten and in prison. And the prisoners were listening to them. And suddenly there was a great earthquake so that the foundations of the prison were shaken. And immediately all the doors were opened and everyone's bonds were unfastened. And when the jailer woke and saw the prison doors were open, he drew his sword and was about to kill himself, supposing the prisoners had escaped, right? The Romans had a rule, you get the fate of your prisoners. If they are carried through to execution, you're fine. But if they escape, you get the execution that they were supposed to have. So if the prison doors opened for you and you served the living God and had just been singing to him in the middle of the night, wouldn't you read this as, oh, the Lord has delivered us? I would. I'd be out of that prison so fast, but these guys are like, nah, we'll stick around because we're a little bit concerned about the Roman soldier and whether or not he'd kill himself. Paul cried with a loud voice, hey, don't harm yourself. We all stuck around because we love you. And the jailer called for lights and rushed in, and trembling with fear, he fell down before Paul and Silas, which is a very interesting position to be in before the people you were just beating. He falls down before them, and he brought them out, and he said, sirs, what must I do to be saved? See, you need to explain to me why it is that you loved like that, because nobody else would ever do it, and yet you guys did it. Why? Who's this God you're singing about? What gives you joy in the midst of all this sorrow? Why are you able to continue even though the persecution keeps coming after you? Why? You tell me why. And they said, look, believe in the Lord Jesus and you'll be saved, you and your household. And they spoke the word of the Lord to him and to all who were in his house. And glorify God on the day of visitation. Look, I'll finish with this. One of my favorite, she is my favorite person. She's my wife. My wife is the best Christian I know. I tell people that all the time. And she is. She's been that way for years. She was a pastor's daughter. Used to say she never wanted to become a pastor's wife. Don't ever tell God what you won't do. Got that? So she had to move. You know, sometimes pastors move at particular times that are hard. You know, the church gets in a position that's difficult. And her father decided when she was a junior in high school that they were going to move from a connected university town to a town that had about 2,000 people in it and was a farming community in the middle of nowhere. So she moved to there, and the school that she started going to had something like, I don't know, 40 kids in her class. She was literally the new girl. They didn't show up very often. She's very pretty. So all the boys were like, cool. And a lot of the girls were like, not cool. So she started playing volleyball. She's a really good athlete. She started playing volleyball, and some of the girls on her team started being real mean to her. They realized, of course, that she was a Christian and that she would get a little embarrassed when people would start saying things that were really, you know, lurid and, you know, overly sexual and stuff. And so they decided, we're going to take advantage of this. And so she was in computer class one day in this early days of the internet, right? So she gets an electronic message while she's on the other side of the class, and it has all this lurid sexual detail describing her, all the things, you know, the boys, and all the stuff. She turns red. Of course she does. And she looks around, and she looks over, and there's this group of girls from her volleyball team giggling, because we got you, the new girl. She was treated very poorly, didn't have a lot of friends, cried lots of tears, wished that she had never come. Anyway, she graduates, and she decides that she's going to leave and never go back, right? So she moves across the state of Washington, goes to a college where she ends up meeting me. And when I'm graduating from college, after we've been married for a little bit, they called her father-in-law, my father-in-law, he ended up calling and saying, hey, you want to come back here and be a youth pastor? I'm like, cool. Hey, honey, is that a good idea? And she's like, uh-uh. No, I'm not going back to that place. But being the noble Christian she is, yeah, okay, we'll do it. We go back to this location. It's just as hard. There's 2,000, little tiny school. She goes back to this town that she never wanted to be back in. Anyway, one of the girls who was part of that volleyball team contacted her just after the, you know, that we arrived. And this girl came to our apartment, sat down, and she said to my wife, Jeannie, she said, listen, I got to tell you, I'm so sorry that I was part of that group that was treating you so poorly. But I got to tell you, I'd never seen anybody handle stuff like that way. Like, I just have a lot of regard for the way that you live out your faith. What you say and what you do are the same thing. And you didn't respond in anger or revenge. You responded with kindness to us all the time. And so I just got to tell you that, you know, I've, of course, graduated and been here for a little while, but I've started to go to church because I just, you know, the God that you serve is the one that I want to serve. You have no idea who it is that's watching you. You're uniquely planted in lots and lots of different places in your life, and you have no idea who's looking at you. My concern and my question is, when they're looking at you, what do they see? Do they see a person who, when they say they believe a thing, they believe it? When they say, don't worry, God's in control, they live like God's in control? When they say that there's joy in the Lord, do they have joy in the Lord? Don't be greedy. Are you greedy? Generosity is a really good thing. Are you generous? Will they glorify God on the day of visitation because of what they saw in you? Let me pray. Father, I'm thankful for the fact that we are a royal priesthood, a holy nation, and a people for God's own possession. And that, you know, it's hard to answer the questions like I raise them there. I even hear them myself. And I don't think there's any real self-aware Christian who doesn't wonder whether or not our profession or our practice are matched as well as they should be. Father, I pray that you first remind us that when that's the case, the solution is not to, you know, take whips out and start beating ourselves, but to start at the start. We are your children. Remind us of who we are. And then, Father, give us the resources that we need to fight that inner battle. Work out your salvation with fear and trembling, for God is the one who wills and acts according to his good pleasure. So God, you say that you're going to come right alongside, and you just want us to take the step of faithfulness. I pray, Lord, there's lots of steps of faithfulness this week that could be had. Defenses that need to be shored up in our own lives, decisions that need to be made, Lord, that we would honor you and trust you and give no quarter to the flesh. So, Father, I pray that that would be the case. And I pray, ultimately, that what's said here in this passage would be the outcome, that there are people all around who would see the effect that you have on our lives, and they would glorify you on the day you visit. And what a day that'll be, we pray. Come, Lord Jesus. It's in his name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Would you stand as we respond? You know where I
Well, we know there's no hiding that the Christian life is not always easy. But it is really good. And we cannot forget that Jesus is victorious, that he does win, that he does have power over sin and death. And so the same Holy Spirit that raised Jesus Christ from the dead lives in you. And so we can win this war against sin. Our God is victorious. And because he's victorious, because we've seen that in our lives, we know that Jesus is great. There is nothing better than Jesus. There's nothing better than obedience to him. And so what we get to do now is we get to go and we get to show everyone else around us that Jesus is great. You know how I know that Jesus is great? Because I've walked in what he's set before me, and it's good. And I want to show you how good it is by the way that I live my life. That's what we get to do. You're a royal priesthood. You're a child of God. So let's go and show people how great it is to belong to him. And so as you leave today, you can give to the special offering at the door. You can give to High Five and Camp Scholarships as you leave. If this is your first time at Harvest Bible Chapel, I'd love to meet you. Or if you're new and you just want to get connected, please come stop by the welcome booth. But if you're especially having a difficult time with battling sin or walking with Jesus or whatever it is, know that if you come up for prayer, it's not admitting defeat. It's admitting a victory. It's confessing the victory of Jesus over whatever is going on in my life. So don't leave without having somebody pray over you, if that would be a blessing to you today. But for all of us, as we go to profess Jesus, to show people how great Jesus is, remember that you are loved.